Hachette Audio presents The End of Power. From boardrooms to battlefields and churches to states. Why being in charge isn't what it used to be. Written by Moises Naim. Read by Matthew Kugler. Preface. How this book came about. A personal note. Power may feel abstract, but for those who are most attuned to it, namely the powerful themselves, its flow and ebb can have a visceral edge. After all, those in positions of great power are best positioned to spot limits on their effectiveness and to feel frustration over the gap between the power they expect their rank to convey and the power they actually have. In my own small way, I experienced such constraints back in February 1989. At the time, I had been named, at age 36, the Minister of Development in the then democratic government of my home country, Venezuela. Soon after we took office in a landslide election victory, we faced riots in Caracas, triggered by the anxiety over our plans to cut subsidies and raise fuel prices, that paralyzed the city with violence, fear, and chaos. Suddenly, and despite our victory and apparent mandate, the economic reform program that we had championed acquired a very different meaning. Instead of symbolizing hope and prosperity, it was now seen as the source of street violence, increased poverty, and deeper inequality. But the most profound insight I had at that time was one I would not fully comprehend until years later. It dwelt in the enormous gap between the perception and the reality of my power. In principle, as one of the main economic ministers, I wielded tremendous power. But in practice, I had only a limited ability to deploy resources, to mobilize individuals and organizations, and, more generally, to make things happen. My colleagues and even the president had the same feeling, though we were loath to acknowledge that our government was a hobbled giant. I was tempted to chalk this up to Venezuela itself. Surely our sense of powerlessness had to do with our country's notoriously weak and malfunctioning institutions. Such weakness could not be universal. Yet later, I would appreciate that it was universal indeed, or nearly so, among those with the experience of power. Fernando Henrique Cardoso, the respected former president of Brazil and founding father of that country's success, summed it up for me. I was always surprised at how powerful people thought I was, he told me when I interviewed him for this book. Even well-informed, politically sophisticated individuals would come to my office and ask me to do things that showed they assumed I had far more power than I really did. I always thought to myself, if only they knew how limited the power of any president is nowadays. When I meet with other heads of state, we often share very similar recollections in this respect. The gap between our real power and what people expect from us is the source of the most difficult pressure any head of state has to manage. I heard something similar from Joschka Fischer, one of Germany's most popular politicians and a former vice chancellor and foreign minister. Since I was young, I was fascinated and allured by power, Fischer told me. One of my biggest shocks was the discovery that all the imposing government palaces and other trappings of government were in fact empty places. The imperial architecture of governmental palaces masks how limited the power of those who work there really is. Over time, I would glean similar observations, not just from heads of state and government ministers, but also from business leaders and the heads of foundations and major organizations in many fields. And it soon became clear that something more was going on, that it wasn't simply that the powerful were bemoaning the gap between their perceived and actual power. Power itself was coming under attack in an unprecedented way. Every year since 1990, I have attended the World Economic Forum's annual meeting in Davos, frequented by the world's most powerful people in business, government, politics, the media, non-governmental organizations, science, religion, and culture. In fact, I have been lucky enough to attend and speak at almost all of the most exclusive power fests in the world, including the Bilderberg Conference, the annual meeting of media and entertainment tycoons in Sun Valley, and the annual meetings of the International Monetary Fund. My conversations each year with fellow participants confirmed my hunch. The powerful are experiencing increasingly greater limits on their power. The reactions to my probing always pointed in the same direction. Power is becoming more feeble, transient, and constrained. But this is not a call to feel sorry for those in power. Powerful people bemoaning their powerlessness is certainly no reason for hand-wringing in our winner-take-all world. Rather, my aim is to delineate the impact of the decay of power. In the chapters ahead, I explore this process of decay, its causes, manifestations, and consequences, in terms of the ways it affects not just the 1% at the top, but more importantly, the vast and growing middle class, as well as those who seek merely to make it through another day. Moises Naim, March 2013. Chapter 1. The Decay of Power. This is a book about power. Specifically, it is about how power, the capacity to get others to do or to stop doing something, is undergoing a historic and world-changing transformation. Power is spreading, and long-established big players are increasingly being challenged by newer and smaller ones. And those who have power are more constrained in the ways they can use it. We often misunderstand or altogether overlook the magnitude, nature, and consequences of this transformation. It is tempting to focus exclusively on the impact of the internet and other new technologies, on the direction of power shifts from one player to another, or on the question of whether the soft power of culture is displacing the hard power of armies. But those perspectives are incomplete. Indeed, they can obscure our understanding of the fundamental forces that are changing how power is acquired, used, kept, and lost. We know that power is shifting from brawn to brains, from north to south, and west to east, from old corporate behemoths to agile startups, from entrenched dictators to people in town squares and cyberspace. But to say that power is shifting from one continent or country to another, or that it is dispersing among many new players, is not enough. Power is undergoing a far more fundamental mutation that has not been sufficiently recognized and understood. Even as rival states, companies, political parties, social movements, and institutions or individual leaders fight for power as they have done throughout the ages, power itself, what they are fighting so desperately to get and keep, is slipping away. Power is decaying. To put it simply, power no longer buys as much as it did in the past. In the 21st century, power is easier to get, harder to use, and easier to lose. From boardrooms and combat zones to cyberspace, battles for power are as intense as ever, but they are yielding diminishing returns. Their fierceness masks the increasingly evanescent nature of power itself. Understanding how power is losing its value and facing up to the hard challenges this poses is the key to making sense of one of the most important trends reshaping the world in the 21st century. This is not to say that power has disappeared or that there aren't still people who possess it in abundance. The President of the United States or China, the CEO of JP Morgan or Shell Oil, the executive editor of the New York Times, the head of the International Monetary Fund, and the Pope continue to wield immense power, but less so than their predecessors. The previous holders of these jobs not only dealt with fewer challengers and competitors, but they also had fewer constraints in the form of citizen activism, global markets, and media scrutiny on using the power they had. As a result, today's power players often pay a steeper and more immediate price for their mistakes than did their predecessors. Their response to that new reality, in turn, is reshaping the behavior of those over whom they have power, setting in motion a chain reaction that touches every aspect of human interaction. The decay of power is changing the world. The goal of this book is to prove these bold assertions. Have you heard of James Black Jr.? The forces driving the decay of power are manifold, intertwined, and unprecedented. To see why, turn your mind from Clausewitz, the Fortune 500 rankings, and the top 1% of the U.S. population that accounts for a disproportionately large chunk of the nation's income, and consider the case of James Black Jr., a chess player from a working-class family in the Bedford-Stuyvesant neighborhood of Brooklyn, New York. By the time he was 12, Black had become a master at chess, a ranking achieved by fewer than 2% of the 77,000 members of the United States Chess Federation, and only 13 of those masters were under 14. The year was 2011, and Black has a good shot at becoming a grandmaster, a ranking awarded by the World Chess Federation based on the player's performance in tournaments with titled players. Grandmaster is the highest title a chess player can attain. Once obtained, the title is held for life. When Black became a master, he was following in the footsteps of America's youngest grandmaster ever, Ray Robson of Florida, who attained that status in October 2009. 2 weeks before his 15th birthday. Black taught himself the game on a cheap plastic set he bought at Kmart and quickly moved on to chess books and computer programs. His idol is Mikhail Tal, a Russian world chess champion of the 1950s. What motivates Black, in addition to his enjoyment of the game, is the way it lets him wield power. As he told a reporter, "I like to dictate what the other player has to do, as clear a statement of the innate urge for power as one can find." But the achievements of James Black and Ray Robson are no longer exceptional. They are part of a global trend, a new phenomenon that has swept through the long closed world of competitive chess. Players are learning the game and achieving mastery at much younger ages. There are more grandmasters now than ever before, 1,200 plus today versus 88 in 1972. And as newcomers defeat established champions with increasing frequency, the average tenure of the world's top players is trending down. Moreover, today's grandmasters hail from far more diverse backgrounds than did their predecessors. As the writer D.T. Max observed, in 1991, the year the Soviet Union broke up, the top 9 players in the world were from the USSR. By then, Soviet-trained players had held the world championship for all but 3 of the past 43 years. Not anymore. More competitors are now capable of climbing to the top of the chess leagues, and they come from a wide variety of nations and neighborhoods. But once they reach the top, they have a hard time staying there. As Mig Greengard, a chess blogger, observed, "You've got 200 guys walking the planet who, with a little tailwind, are playing strongly enough to beat the world champion." In other words, among today's grandmasters, power itself is no longer what it used to be. What explains these changes in the world's chess hierarchy? In part, but only in part.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.